So hi everyone, till now we have completed two layers, the physical layer and the data link layer. Now we are going to see the network layer. So why we need the network layer? As you can see on the screen, there are different local area networks are connected to each other using the routers. Now suppose one device A wants to send data to another device B in the same network, it can send data using the physical address. But suppose the device A wants to send data to another device in another network, suppose device C, then it cannot send data using the physical address. So for that, it requires the IP address. So using the physical address, device can send data to its adjacent node only, but using the IP address, device can send data to another network. That is why the physical address is responsible for node-to-node delivery, but the IP address is responsible for device-to-device or one network to another network delivery. These are the responsibilities of the network layer. The first responsibility is IP addressing. The second is routing and forwarding. Third is transition from IPv4 to IPv6. In that, we will cover the dual stack tunneling and the header translation. The fourth responsibility is different protocols, which is ICMP, IGMP, ARP, and RARP. In this session, we are going to discuss each responsibility in brief, and in future sessions, we will discuss each and every responsibility in detail. Let's discuss the IP addresses. There are two types of IP addresses, IPv4 and IPv6. This is the example of the IPv4, which is represented in the dotted decimal. Now, what is the meaning of dotted decimal? Dotted decimal means that each number is represented in decimal and it is separated by dot. So it is represented in decimal and separated by dots, right? And if you convert each decimal number into binary, it will be represented in 8 bits. So each and every number separated by dots will be represented in 8 bits. So total it becomes 32 bits in length, which means that there are 2^32 IP addresses available worldwide. That is equal to 4 billion. Now you may be thinking that it is a very large number and this number is enough. But let me tell you that as of the 2020, there are 20 billion devices are connected to internet, and that is why the IPv4 isn't enough and we are shifting to IPv6. And the last chunk of IPv4 was allocated in 2012. So you may be wondering that how we can still use the IPv4. So that is a question for you, and you have to find answer. The second type of IP address is IPv6, and it is represented by colon hexadecimal. Means that each number is represented in hexadecimal and they are separated by colons, and the length of the IPv6 is 128 bits. So there are 2^128 IP addresses are available, and that is very large number, and there is no possibility that we need one more version for the internet protocol. Now let's discuss the transition from IPv4 to IPv6. As of now, the internet is not shifted from the IPv4 to IPv6 totally. There are many devices which are still using the IPv4, and there are new devices which are joining the internet using the IPv6. So the devices that are using the IPv6 are should be able to communicate the devices which are still using the IPv4. So to do that, we need to develop a mechanism which is called the transition from IPv4 to IPv6. So you can see on the screen, there are two regions in which devices are following the IPv4. But the region between these two regions are following the IPv6. So in the transition from IPv4 to IPv6, we will discuss some methods using which the devices can send and receive data with the device that are using the different IP addresses. Now let's discuss the protocols. The network layer contains four protocols: ICMP, IGMP, ARP and RARP. What is ICMP? It is an Internet Control Message Protocol. For example, it happens when you try to connect to internet on your laptop and you receive an error that you are not able to connect to the internet, right? So the error message that you are getting on your screen is generated by the ICMP. Then there is IGMP, which is Internet Group Management Protocol, and this protocol tells you that how you can send data from one device to multiple devices. In this protocol, we will see that how the multicast IP addresses are used. The third type, the third protocol is ARP, which is Address Resolution Protocol. This protocol binds the IP address to the MAC address, and the Reverse Address Resolution Protocol binds the MAC address to IP address. So in the transport layer, the segments are generated and the segment will be passed to the network layer, and the segment will be encapsulated in the network layer and the header will be added, and together it will be called a packet. So in the packet, the data is received from the upper layer and header is added, right? Now let's see what is inside the header. Inside the header, there are many fields and length of each field is 32 bit. And there are total 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6 fields. So together 32 into 6 means 192 bits is the maximum length possible for header. Let's see each and every field, and after that we are going to discuss in detail. So the first field is IP protocol number, is of 4 bits. Then there is header length, also 4 bits. Service, 8 bits. Total length, 16 bits. Then identification, flag and fragmentation offset. And time to live, protocol, header checksum, source IP, destination IP and option. Now what is the meaning of the version field? This field tells that what type of protocol the sender is working. It can be IPv4 or IPv6. Header length represents that what is the length of the header in bytes. Then there is type of service. So the type of service means that how the packet should be used. So in this field, there are many options possible, such as delay, reliability, minimum cost, throughput, etc. Then there is total length. This field tells that what is the total length of packet in bytes. After that, these three fields, identification, flags and fragmentation bits, are used when the packet is divided into more than one parts. So suppose the packet is divided into three parts. So identification bits tells that what is the number of the packet. Then there is flags. Flags means that the packet is divided into fragments or not. And fragmentation offset is used when we want to combine the packet to its original form. The next field is time to live. To understand the time to live field, let's see an example. That suppose there is device A that want to send packet to this router R, and device A is sending the packet to this router, and after checking this packet, router is forwarding this packet to this router, and this router is checking and forwarding the packet to this router, and this router is faulty. So instead of forwarding the packet to router R, this router is forwarding packet to this router, and because of this router is faulty, the packet is in infinite loop and it is wastage of bandwidth and it is creating unnecessary traffic. So for that we require time to live. So time to live field means that when sender is sending packet, it will put one number to the time to live field. And when the packet is received by each router, the value of the time to live will be decremented by one. So when this router receives the packet, it will become 4, and when it receives the packet 3, then it becomes 2, then it becomes 1, and it becomes 0. And when the value of the time to live becomes 0, the router will discard the packet, so there are no possibilities that it can occupy extra bandwidth. The protocol field tells that what type of protocol the upper layer is using. It can be TCP or UDP. The header checksum is for the error detection, and the source IP is the IP address of the sender, and the destination IP is the IP address of the receiver. And the option field is extra field. Right? So this is it for the introduction. Thank you so much.